Good evening. Welcome to St. John's on this Maundy Thursday service. We're going to begin our service with our first hymn, 445, When You Woke That Morning, Thursday Morning. God, our Father. Almighty God, merciful Father, I, as a troubled and penitent sinner, confess to you all my sins and iniquities, with which I have offended you, and for which I justly deserve your punishment. But I am sorry for them, repent of them, and pray for your grandmother's mercy. For the sake of the suffering and death of your Son, Jesus Christ, be gracious and merciful to me, a poor sinful being. Forgive me my sins, give me your Holy Spirit for the amendment of my sinful life, and bring me to life everlasting. Amen. Almighty God in his mercy has given his Son to die for us, and for his sake forgives us all of our sins. That through the Holy Spirit he cleanses us and gives us power to proclaim the mighty deeds of God, who called us out of darkness into the splendor of his light. As he called and ordained minister of Christ's church, and by his authority, I therefore declare to you the entire forgiveness of all your sins, in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. We continue with the responsive reading of Psalm 116. What shall I render to the Lord?
For all his benefits to me,
I will lift up the cup of salvation
and call upon the name of the Lord.
I will pay my vows to the Lord
in the presence of all his people.
Precious in the sight of the Lord
is the death of his saints.
O Lord, I am your servant, the son of your maidservant.
You have loosed my bonds.
I will offer to you the sacrifice of thanksgiving
and will all accompany the Lord.
I will pay my vows to the Lord
in the presence of all his people,
in the courts of the house of the Lord.
In your midst, O Jerusalem, praise the Lord.
Glory be to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Spirit, as it was in the beginning, is now, and will be forever. Amen. The Lord be with you. Let us pray together the call of the day. We pray. O Lord Jesus, since you have left us a memorial of your passion and a wonderful sacrament, grant, we pray, that we may so use this sacrament of your body and blood that the fruits of your redeeming work may continually be in spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. Read to you from the Old Testament lesson, Exodus chapter 24. We read, Moses came and told the people all the words of the Lord and all the rules. And all the people answered with one voice and said, all the words that the Lord has spoken, we will do. And Moses wrote down all the words of the Lord. He rose early in the morning and built an altar at the foot of the mountain, and 12 pillars according to the 12 tribes of Israel. And he sent young men of the people of Israel who offered burnt offerings and sacrificed peace offerings of oxen to the Lord. And Moses took half of the blood and put it in basins, and half of the blood he threw it against the altar. Then he took the book of the covenant and read it in the hearing of the people. And they said, all that the Lord has spoken, we will do, and we will be obedient. And Moses took the blood and threw it on the people and said, behold, the blood of the covenant that the Lord has made with you in accordance with all these words. Then Moses and Aaron and Nadab and Abihu and 70 of the elders of Israel went up, and they saw the God of Israel. There was under his feet, as it were, a pavement of sapphire stone, like the very heaven for clearness. And he did not lay his hand on the chief men of the people of Israel. They beheld God and ate and drank. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
We continue with the gradual. Christ entered the most holy place once for all by his own blood, having obtained eternal redemption. He is the mediator. covenant,
that those who are called may receive the promised eternal inheritance.
He provided redemption for his people.
He ordained his covenant forever.
Our second lesson is written in Hebrews chapter 9. We read, but when Christ appeared as the high priest of the good things that have come, then through the greater and more perfect tent, not made with hands, that is, not in this creation, he entered once and for all into the holy places, not by means of the blood of goats and calves, but by means of his own blood, thus securing eternal redemption. For if the blood of goats and bulls and the sprinkling of defiled persons with the ashes of a heifer sanctify for the purification of the flesh, how much more will the blood of Christ, who through the eternal Spirit offered himself without blemish to God, purify our conscience from dead works to serve the living God? Therefore, he is the mediator of a new covenant, so that those who are called may receive the promised eternal inheritance, since a death has occurred that redeems them from their transgressions committed under the first covenant. For where a will is involved, the death of the one who made it must be established, for a will takes effect only at death, since it is not in force as long as the one who made it is alive. Therefore, not even the first covenant was inaugurated without blood. For when every commandment of the law had been declared by Moses to all the people, he took the blood of the calves and goats with water and scarlet wool and hyssop and sprinkled them both the book itself and all the people, saying, this is the blood of the covenant that God commanded for you. And in the same way he sprinkled with the blood, both the tent and all the vessels used in worship. Indeed, under the law, almost everything is purified with blood, and without the shedding of blood, there is no forgiveness. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
We continue with the next hymn, 422, O my heart and Christ, your image. Began to say to them, one after another, is it I, Lord? He answered, "He who has dipped his hand into the dish with me will betray me. The Son of Man goes as it is written of him, but woe to that man by whom the Son of Man is betrayed. It would have been better for him if he had not been born." And Judas, who would betray him, answered, "Is it I, Rabbi?" He said to him, "You have said so." Now as they were eating, Jesus took bread, and after blessing it, broke it, gave it to his disciples, and said, "Take, eat, this is my body." And he took a cup, and when he had given thanks, he gave it to them, saying, "Drink of it, all of you, this is my blood of the covenant, which is poured out for many for the forgiveness of sins. I tell you, I will not drink again of the fruit of the vine until that day when I drink it new with you in my Father's kingdom." And when they had sung a hymn, it went out to the Mount of Olives. This is the Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, O Christ.
We continue with confession of our faith written through the words of the Nicene Creed. I believe in one God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and of all things visible and invisible, and in one Lord Jesus Christ, the only begotten Son of God,
begotten of his Father before all worlds,
God of God, light of light, very God of very God,
begotten, not made,
being of one substance with the Father, by whom all things were made,
who for us men and for our salvation came down from heaven and was incarnate by the Holy Spirit of the Virgin Mary and was made man and was crucified also for us under Pontius Pilate. He suffered and was buried, and the third day he rose again according to the Scriptures and ascended into heaven and sits at the right hand of the Father. And he will come again in glory to judge both the living and the dead, the kingdom of heaven and earth. And I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord and giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son, who with the Father and the Son together is worshipped and glorified, who spoke by the prophets. And I believe in the holy Christian and apostolic church. I acknowledge my baptism for the remission of sins, and I look for the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen.
Our next hymn is 433, Glory Be to Jesus.
Thank you.
which is poured out for many. Truly I say to you, I will not drink again of the fruit of the vine until that day when I drink it new in the kingdom of God. We never have seen anything like this. What will happen next? Life is out of our control. Death and destruction are all around us. The government is helpless. The economy is ruined. Am I talking about the United States of America in April of 2020 battling COVID-19? No, I'm talking about the land of Egypt 3,500 years ago. The one true and almighty Lord of the universe has sent 9 plagues upon Egypt. The death of the firstborn son will now mark the 10th and final plague. On every house not protected by the blood of consecrated lambs, the Lord will bring about the death of the firstborn sons. On the other hand, the Lord's destroyer will pass over those houses marked by the blood of the lamb. This was such a momentous occasion that God commanded his people to celebrate this Passover annually as a memorial meal. Moses told the people, "When your children say to you, 'What do you mean by this service?' you shall say, 'It is the sacrifice of the Lord's Passover, for he passed over the houses of the people of Israel in Egypt when he struck the Egyptians, but spared our houses.'" The 10th plague, however, shocks our modern American sensibilities. What kind of a God would kill innocent children? And why memorialize such a deadly event? But now, let's look deeper. For there's more here than meets the eye. After Moses announced the institution of the Passover, the Bible tells us in Exodus 12 that the people bowed their heads and worshiped. They recognize that when the Lord speaks his will, our only proper response is worship. The Passover is really all about God's first commandment. The 10th plague was divine warfare against God's idolatrous enemies, against the Egyptian false gods and the oppressors of his people. Under all of that Egyptian blood, we should not see innocent victims of an angry God, but instead impenitent sinners receiving their just judgment from the one holy God. All of God's ancient acts of judgment upon idolaters, from the great flood to the plagues to the conquest of Canaan, warn us about the consequences of idolatry and impenitence. They are previews of God's final judgment upon all sinful and unbelieving humanity. Well, this judgment is indeed what we deserve and even more. For our idolatrous sins, for every time that we have not feared out of blood in the most holy place, God provided a means of cleansing and forgiveness for his people's sins. For as we heard earlier in the Hebrews reading, for without the shedding of blood, there is no forgiveness of sins. Well, there is also more than meets the eye in the upper room on the night when Jesus is betrayed. There, he celebrates a Passover meal with Israel's deliverance from Egypt in view and the shed blood of Passover lambs in mind. The disciples of Jesus have celebrated this meal dozens of times with their families from little on, and probably a few times with Jesus as well. They knew that Passover liturgy by heart. They think that they know what is coming as they celebrate the Passover again with Jesus. But there will be much more that meets the eye when Jesus, the Lord of Israel living in our human flesh, fulfills this Passover liturgy right there in their presence. Mark writes, as they were eating, Jesus took bread after blessing and broke it and gave it to them. So far, so good. No surprises yet. But now does come a surprise. Jesus says over the bread, "Take, this is my body." The disciples must have looked at one another with bewildered glances. What did he just say? Then Jesus returns to the regular Passover liturgy. He took a cup, and when he had given thanks, he gave it to them, and they all drank of it. Okay, we're now back to normal, the disciples think, looking at each other with relief. But then comes another bombshell. Jesus says to them, "This is my blood of the covenant, which is poured out for many." To use that very familiar catechism question, what does this mean? At this unprecedented Passover meal, Jesus teaches three main things to his disciples. First, that in a short while, his body would be given and his blood would be shed on the cross. And that by the seemingly senseless slaughter of an innocent man, they should see his death as being the ransom for all of humanity, for the sins of the whole world. This is God's final judgment upon sin. And from that day forward, the only sin that condemns is idolatry. Specifically, the idolatry of rejecting Jesus as Savior and rejecting his death as the final sacrifice for the life of the world. Second, Jesus teaches us here that in a mysterious and supernatural way, there is more than meets the eye under the simple bread and wine of a typical Passover meal. Now, by the power of his word, the bread is truly his body, and the wine is truly his blood, given to his followers for the forgiveness of sins, for life, and for eternal salvation. By his words, "Do this," Jesus gives this Lord's Supper to his church for us to proclaim his death until he returns. And thirdly, Jesus teaches that the Passover and the whole sacrificial system of Old Testament Israel are really just previews of his once and for all sacrificial death upon the cross. Now these Old Testament ceremonies have given way to their New Testament fulfillment in his blood shed for us upon the cross. The very beginning of Jesus' earthly ministry, John the Baptist pointed to Jesus and proclaimed, "Behold, the Lamb of God who takes away the sin of the world." Later on in his mission ministry, St. Paul wrote, "Christ, our Passover lamb, has been sacrificed." At the Last Supper and on Good Friday, John disciples receive as the life-giving blood of Jesus is drunk by us in the Lord's Supper. As the Catechism says, for where there is forgiveness of sins, there is also life and salvation. For when we come in faith to Jesus, feeding on his body given and his blood shed for us in Holy Communion, Jesus promises to us these words of John chapter 6. Whoever feeds on my flesh and drinks my blood has eternal life, and I will raise him up on the last day. For my flesh is true food, and my blood is true drink. Whoever feeds on my flesh and drinks my blood abides in me, and I in him, now and forever. In Jesus' name, amen. And may the peace of God, which passes all understanding, keep your hearts and your minds in our Lord and in our Savior, Jesus Christ. Amen. As we return to our worship folder, we sing the hymn tune from hymn 450, O Sacred Head, Now Wounded.
Instituted the most blessed sacrament to eat and drink, that what is promised promised in his testament may be truly received by his friends and heirs. Have mercy on all who are kept from your table in the extraordinary circumstances, and do not shut them out of your supper forever. Let the words of this testament echo in their ears and hearts, and in true faith, let them believe these words, trusting that they receive spiritually, in faith, exactly what your Son has both won and declared, that is forgiveness of sins. Stir up in us a desire to commune with our fellow Christians on your true body and blood, and bring us soon to the table, Lord, in your mercy.
Hear our prayer.
You know, O Lord, what we need, and you have promised never to abandon us. Help us to endure in faith and with joyful confidence. Receive the blessings of your grace and the answers to our prayers. Through Jesus Christ, the Lord, who lives and reigns with you, the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever.
Amen.
Lord, remember us in your kingdom and teach us to pray.
Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, and as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen.
Oh, give thanks to the Lord, for he is good.
And his mercy endures forever.
Almighty God, through the sacrificial death of your Son, you atoned for the sins of the whole world, and in him you reconciled the world to yourself, not counting our trespasses against us. Receive our humble thanks for the precious gift, salvation, which you comfort and console our humble hearts. Strengthen our faith that we may receive your forgiveness and be at peace. We pray this